Hi and welcome to DIYinvestors.com. This is Mick Pavey talking about tonight about Flybe Group. The ticker for that is FLYB. Now, do you remember that this was one of our picks for 2012? And this video cast is really because the company issued an RNS and a revenue warning on the 10th of January, and one of our subscribers raised an interesting question about it. So I thought I'd just do this video cast to discuss this particular share and one or two other sort of associated issues. So let's briefly remind ourselves what share price it was at the end of 2011, and you can see here that this is the group of 10 shares that we picked for 2012, and here's Flybe Group sitting here at 70.25 pence as at the 31st of December. You'll also remember that it made my Focus 5 for 2012, so it's sitting there as one of 5 shares with £2,000 invested in it in that DIY Investors portfolio. So with the news that came out on the 10th, clearly we need to think about whether to keep it or not. So let's have a look at Flybe for the last 12 months or so. And you may remember from the internet TV broadcast that I did on the 2nd of January that this was one that's what I call a post-IPO faller. And you can see that since it floated, it's been on a downtrend. And I've shown the downtrend marked by this blue line here, and you can see that back in October on the first profit warning, there was a fairly massive share dump, and then it seems to have been sort of bottoming out here. And we'll look at this area in a bit more detail in a moment, but first of all let's take a look at the RNS announcement. This is the 5th of October announcement, which was warning about the first half revenues. So the company seemed to be fairly clued in as to what's happening in terms of keeping their finger on the pulse, because they're obviously looking at monitoring the existing revenue and the seats flown, if you like, month by month. The thing that encouraged me slightly back in October was that they've still got a good cash balance, which is, you can see here, the cash balance is £87.5 million at the end of September. So, you know, the company, bearing in mind that the market capitalization is at £76 million, didn't look like it was going to go bust anytime soon, and that gave some confidence. But of course the share price was still going downwards. So let's just have a little look at the period since this announcement back on the 5th of October through to the current time. Well, before we look at the last few days, what I've done is I've shown you the graph from October through till the end of December 2011, and I've put here, you know, my reasons for choosing Flybe as one of the share picks. Basically, here's the announcement back at the beginning of October, and the share price drop here with a gap down. It's then sort of flattened out, and you can see here that it started a sort of sideways movement. This blue line was that downtrend line that I showed you on the longer term, and you can see here that it's done a lateral, what I call a lateral breakout of that downtrend, but within a secondary flatter downtrend marked by this other blue line. And of course you can see what I was thinking at the end of December, that it's looking very much like it's turning round, because it's broken out of both of those trend lines. It's had a lateral breakout of the longer trend, and then this shorter, flatter downtrend, again it's broken out here. And so at the end of December I was reasonably confident that based on what we knew, that it looked like things might be turning around for Flybe. And on the secondary indicators down below, they were all reasonably positive, particularly the on-balance volume that had broken through in the second half of December. It had broken through the downtrend line that's marked by that orange dotted line. So in essence, not many reasons to doubt that there was a turnaround in progress based on both the technical analysis and being hopeful of reasonable passenger numbers and so on. So for those of you that are not too sure about the typical profile of a post-IPO faller, let's just take a look at Entertainment One as an example. And I've made a note here that Entertainment One is one of my case studies in my book Picking Winning Shares. If you refer to chapter 16.4, you'll see that. I've put there the ISBN numbers of the books. Note in particular on the second line there that I've just put a new Kindle version on Amazon for anybody that might be interested in an ebook version of Picking Winning Shares. It's available from today. So let's move on and take a look at ETO. This is the long-term graph of Entertainment One from when it floated back at the beginning of 2007, showing, as is not uncommon with IPOs, that the price drops off, basically because they're overvalued at the flotation. And basically it went down particularly badly through the crash of tail end of 2008 into early 2009, and we'll come in a moment and just have a look at what happened as it breaks out. But you can see the general pattern. You've got a flotation, you've got either a gradual or sometimes a quite steep drop back to what would be a more sensible valuation for the company based on a more reasonable price to sales ratio, and then you've got a breakout of that downtrend and a gradual recovery. And we'll just take a look in a bit closer detail at Entertainment One. So here we are through the spring and summer of 2009. You can see that there's basically a flattening out. So we've got a steep fall, then a flattening out, and then a lateral breakout, followed by a rise, a drift back, still below the 200-day moving average at this point, then an increase in volume here, a significant increase, which pushes it up through the 200-day moving average, and then, as they say, the rest is history. That's the general uptrend over the period since summer 2009, and Entertainment One's been a particularly good share for me personally, and very good prospects for the company. And on current prices, you're looking at, roughly speaking, about a fourfold increase from its breakout point anywhere here, where you could have bought it knowing that it had broken through the 200-day moving average. And if you bought in somewhere around upper 40s, around 50 pence, you've got a good return on your money in basically a couple of years. So let's move on and look at the questions that one of our subscribers, Mike, has raised. With Mike's permission, I've replicated his question here, and you can see that he said, "I watched your broadcast at the beginning of the year and noted your technical analysis of Flybe, and also noted the company trading report that came out a few days later and putting the dampers on the share price. Perhaps more importantly, the tale of woe the company is saying it is expecting to suffer forward into 2012-13. And then Mike says it seems they might need to scale down their schedules and number of aircraft to continue trading. Second point is basically saying, knowing what this awful state of lower passenger numbers is for them, what's the reason in feeling comfortable about the metrics if the company reporting has been saying, I told you so? Certainly about the first 6 months of 2011, and now again in the last periods of 2011, meaning the second half. The announcement related to the third quarter trading." And he's asking if I'd argue it was a similar case to the shortcomings of LKI, that's Lancom International, and their directors, which misled punters. So Mike's raised some really interesting questions, and I thought I'd set out my views on Flybe. So let's look at the recent RNS announcement from Flybe on the 10th of January. So here's the RNS announcement from the 10th of January, and let's just taking Mike's questions, let's just look at what this announcement is actually telling us. Well, first of all, you can see that it's saying that it's the UK domestic operations, and that accounts for 70% of group revenue, continue to deteriorate. And they're talking about that the first half year-on-year's sales declined by 6%, and third quarter sales fell 8% from the same period a year earlier. Numbers in December being particularly disappointing. But that's slightly offset by revenue from the group's other activities grew by about 20% in the third quarter, driven by Flybe's entry into continental Europe with the Flybe Nordic joint venture. So you've got slightly, you know, you've got bad news and you've got some good news. Unfortunately, the bad news relates to 70% of group revenue. The good news relates to 30% of group revenue. And the bit down the bottom is quite interesting because with reference back to the cash that the company's got, the chief executive is saying that there's a strong balance sheet, UK market leadership and various other opportunities that they've got, including the financing for the new aeroplanes. They're happy with their strategy in the medium and long term. So it's not a catastrophic position that I don't think the company's in. Not in my reading of that announcement anyway. So let's just take a moment to look at the metrics for Flybe. Here I'm showing the printout from ShareScope, looking at the key metrics. Draw your attention first of all to the fact that this is the closing price yesterday, the 17th, 62 pence closing price. That'll be the mid price. The market capitalization of the company's 46.4 million. And looking across here, you can see that the previous year, the revenue, the group revenue was 595 million. I mean, just to round it up and get a rough idea of what figures we're talking about, if we call that 600 million and call that 50, that the price to sales is round about 50 over 300, it's about a sixth, isn't it? So you can work out for yourself that we're talking about less than 0.2 as a price to sales ratio. As I said that, I didn't think that sounded quite right, so I've just, it's quite a bit less than that. It's actually less than 0.1, it's 0.08 to two decimal places for a price to sales ratio. Now that's low, and for a company of this size and this stability with that's recently capitalized through the flotation, I can't see this being in dire trouble in the next few months. That's my own personal view. As ever, we're all DIY investors and we have to make our own minds up. But let me just go on and look at the more recent share price graph. Now I find this quite interesting because back here in October is the sharp drop in price, and then we got sideways movement through the balance of the year up to the end of December. And bear in mind I mentioned about there's the lateral breakout, and there's the slight move up towards the end of December where I'm decided to recommend it. And then here's the 10th of January announcement about third quarter revenues. And although the price gaps down, the day's price activity show it opening, dropping down to about I think it's about 47 pence here, and then closing back at the price that it opened. And then since then, it's crept back up above this line that I've dropped in here, marking the lowest price that it got to back in October. So it's not, on the face of it, going to drop off further. Now, that doesn't mean to say that it won't ease back. And that brings us on to a particularly interesting point about where to set our stop loss and so on. So let's have a look at that now. Just before we do that, I ought to point out one or two things on the secondary indicators. First of all, that price drop with the recent announcement has shown a sell signal on the ADX indicator here, but it also showed a very slight drop off on the on-balance volume. But also, the last few days, that's picked back up and was still on a fairly flattish on balance volume at the moment, at a higher level than we were back at the end of November into the beginning of December. So you can see there that there was clearly some buying going on. There's the on balance volume staying flat through most of December, as we've had, and then this recent action here. Okay, let's look at the stop losses situation. Now again, it's a very personal decision as to how tight you want to set your stop loss. Now bear in mind that we bought in at the for the DIY investors portfolio at 70.25 pence here at the beginning of the year, and I would suggest that based on this action here, if you've not already been stopped out, because if you may have bought here and decided that perhaps that line would be a good support level if it did drift back, and you may have set your stop loss up here, and you may have already been stopped out. If you haven't, you've got to decide where to put your stop loss, because I think there's enough doubt here as to what might happen in the next 2 or 3 months that you want to put a stop loss in to safeguard your interests. Now, personally, I'm prepared, because of the fundamental prospects of the company, to give it a bit of what I call in picking winning shares wiggle room. And that wiggle room to me is marked by these two orange dotted lines that I've dropped in. You see, I've put a horizontal line in which gives a share price value of 47, just over 47 pence, and I've set my stop loss at about 45 pence, because I think that if it goes through there, then it might well go on down for another leg, possibly another it's quite a substantial drop like this, not in terms of actual pence, but in terms of percentage. But I'm hopeful that the prospects will continue to improve and will stay within that range. You may want to set a slightly tighter stop loss. It's a very, very personal decision, and each investor has to make their own mind up on that. But for my two penneth worth, I would set a stop loss at about 45p. In fact, I've actually done that in my SIP where I hold this share. Now, it would be remiss of me not to address Mike's second question, which is a comparison with Lancom International. So let's just spend a few moments looking at that. So this is the share price graph last July for Lancom International. The ticker code is LKI, the EPIC code. And you can see that following a long downtrend, about 3 years I think it was, that there was a sort of lateral breakout here, on a breakthrough there, and then a sort of lateral trend. And following this sale of shares on this volume here, you can see that after that drop, the on-balance volume started to climb. So there seemed to be some growing support for LKI. And here's the interesting part in the summer of 2011. So let's just take a quick look at what was going on there. Well, this is the summer period, and these little markers here are the RNS announcements. And basically, the three here are all basically positive RNS announcements talking about harvest. The harvest in the south is finished, and then the harvest is finished and all the wheat's gathered in, and that the announcement will be coming shortly, and then no hint that there's any major problems until we get this announcement marked by this line here on September the 7th, which causes this rapid drop off in price. And then I've put a horizontal line in, and in recent weeks, tail end of December through into January, it's actually gone through that. And there's actually, as you probably know, a recommended offer for LKI. It's a complete shambles in my opinion, and I don't think I've got any reason to change what I was saying in the end of year review on the 31st of December. And just to remind you what we were saying at the end of December, I've plucked out the text from that review, and you'll recall that I'd said that 15th of July the chairman stated that LKI has returned a maiden interim profit, that's for the first half, and is on target for a full year profit. So this is the 15th of July. closely followed at the end of July 28th by news that the southern harvest was complete and the results were good, although it noted that weather conditions in the west are currently good following poor weather last week, which caused a limited amount of damage to approximately 7% of the rapeseed crop. So just to recap, they're saying that they've been assessing the situation, there's damage to 7% of the rapeseed crop on the 28th of July. 22nd of August, having reported that all the winter wheat and the rapeseed harvest is in, no mention of any poor results, but they're just telling us the results are due next week. Next week turned into 2 weeks, and perhaps there should have been a clue there for us as DIY investors, but on the 7th of September they've done a complete U-turn, saying that they now make a loss and they're going to undertake a strategic review with a view to the future of the company. Now either they didn't know what the hell was going on, or there's somewhere in the system there's a degree of incompetence. They should know week by week how the harvest is going, because you're talking about tractors pulling corn and rapeseed into store, and they'll know from that what the yields are. And with 10 years of farming experience myself, I can only say that as far as LKI is concerned, I feel both misled and deceived because of the particular RNS announcements of these three RNS announcements in July and August, followed 2 weeks later by this. I think I can only describe it as a shock. Any of you that were invested will no doubt feel the same way. And I've said that sell. That's my personal view, and that's what I've done with my own holding. So to sum up and answer Mike's question, which was a really good question that raised some valid points, the situation for Flybe is, in my opinion, different from LKI. I'm content to hold Flybe for the time being with a stop loss underneath. LKI, I wouldn't touch with a barge pole, and I'll be keeping a watch out for any of those directors that might appear in another company, because I'll be avoiding them like the plague there as well. Anyway, thanks for listening, and hope you got something out of that. And basically, IPO, post-IPO fallers are a good sort of stomping ground for DIY investors to look for companies that are well funded from the flotation, and you're looking for the downtrend to stop and to turn, which will be on a more sensible price to sales valuation, and then you're looking to benefit from the recovery. Fingers crossed for Flybe that it does that for the DIY investors portfolio in 2012. So on that note, and while the voice is still holding up, I'll say thanks for listening. Be very interested in your views on Flybe, or even on LKI, come to that, and I wish you well with your investing for 2012. Thanks a lot.